So, one day last February, I was at my work computer avoiding work. And it's not that I hate my job. I teach basic writing skills to adults who are trying to get back into college. I help them get their GED, and I help them find a career path, something better, a better life. And I guess it's just that I've always felt that I was somehow missing my pathway, that I was on the wrong road. So anyway, I'm on the internet this day, and I run into this article about a guy that's very successful independent author. He sold 1 million ebooks last year. So I do a little research, and I find out that ebook sales are up 118% last year. And the independent author got about 25% of that market. So I start to think, maybe ebook sales, writing ebooks, would be a pathway to a writing career. I get busy. I start writing outlines for a dystopia series. Hunger Games is really big. It's a great big genre for ebooks. And I love misery and chaos, so I know I can do this. So I'm up every morning at 4 o'clock and I'm writing outlines for my series. And 2 weeks later, I have enough material for 12 novels. And then this Saturday night, Lynn, my wife and I, were to dinner with our good friends Barb and Don. I get home about 9 o'clock, I'm bush tired, but I pull out the laptop and start writing. And all of a sudden, my fingers, they just started dancing all over the keyboard. They wouldn't stop. I was just like a witness to this. For hours, they went on, no control. Then they stopped. I was dumbfounded. I had 7,000 words of erotica. Now, if you knew me, you'd be shocked too. I'm not a sex sort of guy. I mean, I like sex, but it's just, I'm not obsessed with it. But there it was. I was mortified. Any talent that I had as a writer was not tainted. And I sure as hell couldn't tell anybody what I just did, especially my wife. So, I said, I gotta get rid of this. I gotta delete it. I couldn't. I liked it. So, I put away the dystopia. I still write. I'm up every morning, 4 o'clock, but now I'm writing erotic short stories. And I find a publisher that likes my work. And I start talking to the business manager 2 times a week. And he tells me how to put together a business plan and what the startup costs are going to be for this ebook business. Now, by now, Lynn knows I'm writing. She just doesn't know what I'm writing. And this project's starting to gather some steam, and I'm getting excited. This business manager, he lives in the Keys, Florida, and he introduces me to the chief editor. She lives over here in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm talking to the editor that's going to handle my project, and she's in Boston. And the guy that's going to handle the art and the website, that's Vinny, and he lives in Long Island. And it's just great. I'm having a blast. And then one day, the state of Oregon, I get a call, and there's this job coming up, and they invite me to apply. It's a great job. Huge salary with benefits like health insurance. I don't have health insurance. So this, I discuss with Lynn. And she never once suggests that I take the safe job, the state job. She leaves me alone to make my own decision. So I tell the state, thank you, but no thank you. I'm going to write myself out of the job I do have and buy my own health insurance.
Yeah.
And then I'm up one Friday morning shortly after that. It's 4 o'clock in the morning, and I'm working again. And it happened. Once again, my fingers, they just started flying all over the place. And I was just like a witness, and this other presence took over my hands. And this time, they took me to this place that was quiet. It was a very special place. And in that place, I wrote this perfect scene. And it wasn't even like that, really. It was more like I got out of the way, and out of the void came this wonderful, poignant, tender scene between my main character and one of her many, many suitors. And I was in that scene, and I met her. I met my main character. And then up to that day, I had tried to give her many names, but none of them took. And that Friday morning, she told me her name. Her name is Bronna Flynn. And, well, I know some of you are going to think I'm nuts and I don't care anymore, but the fact is that Bronna is real. She's real. She's not real like you and me, but she's real. And I know her. In another realm, in another universe, she exists. She exists. I know her as my muse. I know her as my mistress. And in that moment, that morning, that Friday morning, I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that I am a writer and I am going to get out of this day job. I just got to figure out how to tell Lynn about the mistress. So later on that morning, it's 9 o'clock, the phone rings. I can hear Lynn. She's getting the results of her biopsy. She's scheduling her surgery. Now on the continuum of cancers, basal cell carcinoma is low. It's a skin cancer, you're not gonna die. But that doesn't matter. The C word is now in our home. And then needs this surgery. And this surgery costs just slightly more than the startup cost for my ebook business. I didn't write the rest of that day. I didn't write Saturday. I didn't write Sunday. I didn't write Monday. I went to work, and I had an email from the state. That job I had turned down was reopened, and the state director wanted to know if I would reconsider. Just about that time, the librarian at Clackamas, Terry, he comes by my office. Now, Terry, he's a kindred spirit. He's an artist. He's a writer, and he knows all about my project. Yes, I told the librarian about the erotica before I told my wife. And I showed Terry the email, and I said, Terry, this is a great job, but I'm going to be commuting to Salem every day. I'm going to be taking trips, being on the road 2 weeks out of every month, and I'm going to be working 70, 80 hours a week. Terry, if I take this job, Bronna is dead. Terry said that Lynn is the most important person in my life, and I must take care of her. Whatever I do, I must put Lynn first. The phone rings, Terry leaves. It's my mole at the state. She wants to know if I've read the article or read the email and if I'm going to apply. And I tell her, yes, I'm going to apply. And she says, good, Steve, listen, you must submit your application by midnight Sunday. I know that's what she said, but what I heard was, Steve, you must admit. I cannot tell you how depressed I was. I didn't know what to do. Well, my good friend and massage therapist, Valeria, I knew she was at Whole Foods that afternoon. She was there with her massage chair. She was giving massage. And that seemed like the only thing to do, so that's what I did. I went to go get a massage. Now, Valeria is a very special masseuse. She's got this amazing connection to healing energies. And I don't know if she knows this, I don't know if I've told her, but I think of her as my adopted grandmother, which is a little odd because I'm pretty sure I'm older than she is. But you see, my grandmother was from Slovakia, and Valeria is from Slovakia. And more than that, Valeria is wise beyond any years. And she said to me, after I told her everything that happened since last Friday, she said to me, Stephen, no, this job is making sick. You must, for Stephen being best, then it's been healing. I lost it. Right there at Whole Foods, I just started crying. I didn't know what to do. So the next week, Lynn has her surgery. Went well, she's fine. The week after that, I have my interview. I nailed it. They tell me there's going to be a decision by 5 o'clock that day. 6 o'clock, my mole calls me, tells me that I nailed it, and that I did not get the job. So, that was last June, and Lynn got the results of her cancer, had her surgery, and I lost my way back then. But I'm back. I still work at Clackamas. I still teach basic skills, basic writing to adults, and I'm back writing. I've reconnected with Bronna, That was difficult. She did not like being ignored at all. But we've reconnected. We're tight. And I tried to stir her away from all that sex, but she wouldn't have it. So we compromised, and now I'm writing Romantica, which is this genre that lives somewhere between romance and erotica. And yes, I eventually did tell Lynn about what I was doing and about my connection to Brana. And I was a little bit put off. She wasn't surprised at all. It was as if she always knew I'd end up writing sex stories. And also, I have to add that thanks to House Bill 2557, I don't know if you keep up with your law, but because of that law, Lynn and I do now have health insurance. We're covered.
Yeah.
Thank you. Lynn, thank you. You know, I look back on that time, it was last spring, and I can see that I've always felt like I was nowhere and that I was trying to get somewhere. I'm no different from the students I teach. They come to me, they want to get their GED, they're desperate, they're discouraged, they're used to being discouraged, and they want so much to be somewhere else. But that's not it. It's not about getting somewhere. A life is partially defined by the company you keep, by the friends you have. And I now know that I'm lost. I'm nowhere without my friends. Terry is a revolutionary spirit, and he's a librarian, so he's always going to point you in the right direction. And he had the courage to tell me the truth. Lynn is the most important person in my life, and I must take care of her. Valeria, an amazing healer, she too had the courage to tell me the truth. I must at all times, at all costs, be true to myself. And my best friend, my wife, Lynn, she has a very quiet courage. She somehow was able to step aside and let me find my own way. And not only that, she said I could keep the mistress as long as she stays in that other universe.